Would anyone like some koala soup?
Presumably a hungry koala.
Of course, it would be a hungry koala. It would be a hungry baby koala. Because koalas are the only animals to make what is called a soup or pap.
What, in a bowl?
They make it in the bowl of their body and it comes out of their...
mouth, ears.
Their bottom, yes, their arse.
Arse, so I get a point for that.
You get a point for knowing arse, yes. Thank very you. Good.
They make soup with their arse?
They make a soup for their young with their arse.
That's just, I mean, that's careless parenting, isn't it?
It was.
I just quite like to ask, why haven't they had that on the Bush Tucker trial in Ireland?
A very good question.
I bring a koala out and hold it over your...
It takes
horrible...
It takes a horrible new meaning to, waiter, there's a hair in my suit.
They're not koala bears, they're not bears.
Well done, they're not bears,
they're
are they?
They're marsupials.
Yes, no. What are they most closely related to?
Kangaroos.
The fish.
Other marsupials.
A wombat, in fact.
A wombat.
Oh, they're wombats. Brothers and sisters.
Wombats don't have soup, they have cubicle feces.
Do they?
Oddly, yes. Little dice.
Cubicular?
Cubicle.
He can't get that leaf down, that he's been chewing it for 10 minutes.
Well, no, isn't that because he's eating the leaves of the eucalyptus tree?
He is, indeed.
Which acts as a powerful hallucinogen on the koala. Mm. So a lot of the time, they're just saying, yeah, whoa. What did I come up here for?
Well,
it's an analgesic rather than a hallucinogen.
I've always got those two mixed up, you know.
It's sort of numb, a painkiller.
It's poisonous.
Yeah.
They have an incredibly long intestine, about a mile long, to digest all that poison that would kill a human.
Yes, what it is, it's really quite interesting, is, and that's what we're here for, to be quite interesting, they can tell, which scientists can't, the age of a eucalyptus leaf. It has to be between... a year and 18 months. If it's any younger, it has no value whatsoever to them.
They sleep for 20 to 22 hours a day.
22 hours a day? I've got to give you 2 points for that. You're absolutely right.
I won a night out with a koala. Yeah, when we were out all night. We went to a restaurant and to a club.
All night.
What do you have? Soup of the day?
What do they drink? What did your koala drink?
Becks.
Secretaries, this doesn't lead me to wonder, why was Squirrel Nutkin such a lying bastard?
I should know this, because I've been to the Beatrix Potter Museum.
Have you? So, where's it, the latest recent one?
Yes. It's quite good. If you like Beatrix Potter, it's amazing.
Yeah. So, we've been talking about lying, we've been talking about faking orgasms.
It's to do with colour, is it?
Is it because he was ginger?
Well, Squirrel Nutkin, as you rightly point out, was a red squirrel, but most other squirrels tend to pretend that they buried their food to trick potential thieves. They dig a hole, they pretend to put a nut inside and cover it up very quickly. All the time, the nut is actually still in their mouth. And then they also recache, so they bury nuts and then they return to them soon afterwards, dig them up and bury them somewhere else. And they sometimes do this 5 times with the same stash. But they did a study in 2008, almost a quarter of all squirrel burials of food at some sites, not of each other.
It's too late. You said squirrel burial. So now they're gorgeous, but they're like...
Yeah. They're mainly unmarked, but you do see little headstones occasionally.
But here's the thing. There has been a debate since at least 1884, and it rages on, whether squirrels remember where they hide their nuts or whether they just hide as many as they can and then return to a likely place.
Define rages.
Well, there have been studies since 1881. There was one in 1991, a study done at Princeton.
Two.
So they don't have a conclusion.
No. The thing is, it rages on. Rages on. There was a fantastic story about a squirrel in 2015. A squirrel got locked into the bar of Honeybourne Railway Club in Worcestershire for the day, OK? It got drunk and caused £300 worth of damage. So the club secretary, a guy called Sam Bolter, he said that all he could find was broken glass and bottles knocked off shelves. There was beer all over the floor, there was money and straws scattered everywhere, and he found the culprit hiding behind a box of crisps, looking, he said, unsteady and worse for wear.
Why are you
did it take 300 years to give the giant tortoise a scientific name?
A scientific name?
Yeah, i.e. the Latin name. It turned out to be called Geocalonia, you know.
Is it because they just thought that was pretty good, giant tortoise?
We'll leave it with that.
Yeah.
I was going to say something about which now is unusable. I'm going to have to say it now.
Go on. No, I'm not with it, man.
They thought...
This better be good.
They thought it was a normal tortoise, but closer, is what I was going to say. I couldn't get that concept. It's like, would it be actually further away? And a normal one further away would be actually a minute one. Would they mistake a quite far away normal one for a miniaturised one that's a bit ornamental?
Yeah, but the thing that you're saying is that the tortoise could be...
If there was like a tortoise over there that was giant, yeah, but I for some reason thought it was just there, then I wouldn't think it was giant. I'd think it was just, oh, there's just one there. It was just a normal tortoise there, nothing about that. Oh my god, it's over there and it's bad!
It would have to be on a huge beach with no other points of reference.
Well, yes, exactly.
Yeah, exactly. You know. Yeah.
Are they?
That's not the reason.
Are they, are they particularly litigious? Now, if you give me a name, I'll sue you.
No, it wasn't that. It's a nice thought again. No, they had another property which was most unfortunate for them to have.
What, the tortoises did?
Yeah. They were edible.
They were so edible. Anyone, so, I mean...
Anyone who saw one couldn't stop to think of a name for it. They just had to eat it straight away.
Eat one of those!
Yeah.
Oh, they're cool.
Just
get one, though, really.
There's no Latin name for the pistachio nut. Exactly the same way. No one can be bothered. Just shut up with your Latin. Eat them. They're brilliant.
That's what happens. No Latin name for Maltesers.
None of them made it. It's kind of true. None of them made it to London. None of them made it to Europe.
This time, we're going to take it and we'll leave it.
However, take it back.
We'll get it on the ferry coming into Dover. There's a bloke going... leaving the door with a tortoise instead.
Seas become as one tortoise left. Yeah. Come on, we'll go back. Let's just go back and get some more.
Yeah. I'm just imagine the moment after they've eaten that last tortoise. They're sitting there thinking, we are twats. I'm too full.
Even Darwin on Darwin's last
tortoise. Dozens.
There were dozens.
He collected every species in the world. Yeah. He ate that one.
They had them all. They did.
Well, it's not all the butterflies. It's not all the beetles. I'm eating that.
The only descriptions of them are comparing them to chicken, beef, mutton, and butter, and saying they're how much better they are than all of those things. No one who'd ever eaten tortoise had ever eaten anything better.
Why not farmed?
And the liver and the bone marrow, every part of it was unbelievably delicious.
Where are they from?
Well, from the tropics, mostly.
Are there flights over there?
They are now protected. All 12 species.
They're that delicious, they can't be. Well, we've protected them. They're all in there. No need to look.
They're fine. There's a border around them, like North Korea.
Yeah. There's a big pile of shells, like those piles of tyres you see in a scrapyard.
But there were some that survived, however, and let me tell you about a very extraordinary
that
one.
That bloke there, he's just befriending that one. Yeah, come over here, my pretty. Yeah. I'm trying to think of a name for you.
But they are amazing animals, apart from how delicious they are. Advaita died in 2006, and he was Clive of India's pet. There he is.
Oh, they're 200 years old or something.
255. He was born
before Mozart, before the French Revolution, and his death was announced on CNN. I mean, that's a heck of a life, isn't
And you
it?
Can list his achievements on the back of a stamp.
Well, why did he need to?
Well, his principal achievement is it wasn't...
He lived 255 years. People think probably the oldest living creature because they don't live so long out of captivity like most animals, and he was, you know, well cared for. But that is a pretty astonishing
lifespan. It is quite. So it lived 255 years and is massive. I mean, I've achieved 50% of that. That's great.
There are 12 species of them, all of them endangered. Well,
they
one.
All taste nice.
Well, I don't know, but it's very sad that they have so many where other species were, you know, basically wiped out just because they were so lovely. Not only that, they were also used as water stores. It sounds a weird thing, but they have a special kind of internal bladder that stores water so perfectly that it's drinkable. When you slit them open to cook them, you also get, you know, like a gallon of fresh water.
Wow.
So they would stack them up on boats, tons of them. They'd be stacked up, one on the other, and they couldn't move. And they didn't need to be fed for months, so that they actually contributed a lot to whaling and other things because they were used as a foodstuff and a water supply that was just kind of permanent.
So you've got the water as well. And imagine if you smash the shell open, there's like a little toy in there, like a Kinder. Like a little game, you've got to get the balls in the holes.
Yeah. Oh, so how do they exist in the wild anyway, if they're so delicious and slow-moving and massive and useful?
They didn't have any natural predators until man discovered them, basically. Right.
So they were evolutionarily complacent.
They were exactly like a lot of island species. They're a lot like that. And it's only man who crosses islands in the way we do who does it.
All those ridiculous flightless birds on New Zealand.
Yeah.
Essentially, they got lazy.
Yeah.
They got lazy. What's the point the of flying? Now, some of them go, we'll need it one day. I bet we'll need it one day. Nah. You're too anal, you are. Just walk around, it's easier.
Yeah. Anyway, despite being discovered in 1535, giant tortoises weren't properly catalogued by science until the early 19th century because they were so delicious that no samples ever made it back home. What kind of creature has a terrible memory? Short memory.
My dad can't remember anything. I went round to see him the other day and he looked at me like that.
Doesn't everybody?
I went, hi, Dad. He went, oh.
My neighbour's dog doesn't remember when I kick it, because I do it. No, it knows the time. It still comes up to me.
Oh.
I'll kick it really hard in the face.
Goldfish.
A goldfish. With my boot.
Oh, not goldfish.
No, there is... 3-second memory.
Well, there is this fallacy that goldfish have a 3-second memory. It is a fallacy. They've done tests.
Oh, they have.
They have. A man from Plymouth University did wonderful tests.
Said to the goldfish what happened on EastEnders last night. And he remembered most of it.
Two things. One, there isn't a Plymouth University. That's made up. And two, they can't remember anything.
Yeah, it's a sweet shop with a copy of the Times in it, isn't it?
Dr. Phil G of the University of Plymouth's psychological
department. Is he a rapper?
He does sound like that, Dr. Phil G. He trained them to press levers. And they could even tell time because he would have the lever work just for an hour in the day and they would come and press at the right time to deliver food. And they knew exactly where it was and they would come back to it.
And how come they can't tell that the deep sea diver is 3 times as big as the castle? Damn smart.
Well, it seems they have pretty good memories, as a matter of fact. What's more, they're not gold. Put them back in the wild, they go to brown and other different colours.
It's actually not true, because I've got 2 in a pond. They've been there 5 years, they're still orange. So...
No, in the wildy-wildy-wildy, but if you're in captivity and
Where's
for some
the
reason...
Where's the wildy-wildy-wildy? I'd like to go there.
Technical term.
Norfolk.
So what can't remember anything, then? I bet a koala can't remember much. Wakes up... Oh, hot.
I bet a pig on fire can't remember much.
I had a strange experience when I was in Australia recently and I went to a day out to the zoo and they give you a koala to hold and you have a photograph taken of it. And koalas are very lazy animals. They don't exactly work out. You know what I mean? They haven't got firm buttocks or anything. And I had one in my hand and it kind of just slipped. And like, before I knew it, I actually had a sort of koala's buttocks. It was actually slipped onto my finger. And it just sort of slid on and there's... On the photograph, they take a photograph of you, supposed to say, hold the koala. And the koala goes, this goes. worst thing was they wanted it back. And I said, well, can I hold it for a bit longer? And I was trying to get the finger out. And I said, can I take it away?
The list of charges is beginning to add up, isn't it?
During the First World War, Seagulls were trained to search out German submarines and then crap on their periscopes. Pretty clear message. But what is this camel behind me trying to tell you here? What's going on?
Oh, dear.
That's a very disgusted audience, though. They don't like what they see.
Did you say Jeremy Carl's on in a minute?
Do you know, what are we looking at there?
I presume it's a tongue, is it? But is it a sausage?
It's not his tongue, amazingly.
Is it his stomach?
It's his palate. It can blow part of his soft palate out. It's called the palatinus diverticulus. It's known as a gullet, and it's used as, again, we've been discussing, it's used in mating. It's used to attract females.
Oh, you really sexy beast, you.
Yeah, it's a heck of a thought, isn't it?
It's not working for me.
It appears to be sticking out its tongue. The camels with the most testosterone have the biggest gullet.
That's what they tell you.
Yeah.
It's like that nonsense about bald men being full of testosterone.
Yeah,
oh,
I know, bless. But no, the size. Well, hey.
Phil's not insulted because he doesn't know. Phil doesn't know he's bald.
I don't know. What do you mean, bald?
He's convinced he's got a big, thick, luscious head of hair.
Well, down my back there is.
Well, I've got that.
Anyway, they do that. They blow out their gullet and they make a blue, blue, blue noise, apparently.
Yeah, blue, blue, blue. That's the best they've come up with after all these years.
In Saudi Arabia and other countries, they often cut the gullet out. Why would they do that? Do you know why?
To stop it? They cut it out?
It's so they breathe better for camel racing.
Oh, camel racing. Yeah.
Actually, in Saudi Arabia, they import camels from...
Kent.
Yeah. You set them up so well, Steve.
Kind from Kent. No, not from Kent.
From Hertfordshire.
Not. Let's disabuse ourselves. Australia is the right answer, yes. Thank you. But why would they import them? What do they need them for?
They're very good at cricket, the Australian one.
The Australian camels are actually much fitter than the.
Oh, look, we like sports.
Yeah.
It's a big outdoors.
No, they don't use them to race, they don't use them for transport, they use the camels they import for...
Food?
Freedom. Food for meat, camel meat.
They tell them they're going to have a lovely life of camel meat. You'll love it over there, mate. Away you go. Good luck. Give us a call when you've won your first race.
Give as many uses for a pig as you can.
Bacon.
Bacon is one.
Truffle snaffling.
Medicine stuff, medicine cases for tablets and...
Oh, for women in pregnancy, doesn't it bring on for inducing pregnancy?
It does if one hormones. Runs through your front row.
Absolutely staggering what you can get out of a
yogurt.
Pig. Yes, I have a list. Christian Mindertstma wrote a book called Pig 05049, which is an anonymous pig. And beyond the obvious foodstuffs, she found different parts of this animal offered the following pork derivatives. From the skin alone, safety gloves, cosmetic surgery, collagen, comes from pig skin, energy bars, which also have collagen in, low-fat butter, chewing gum, X-ray film, drug capsules, bread, flour improver made from pig hair, would you believe? Flour, I know. The skin is also used for tattoo practice. And ballistic gelatin. That's just the skin. Then there's the internal organs, pet food. Tambourine skins are made from a pig's bladder. Your old tambourine.
I knew those folkies were evil. Yeah.
There are many thousands of people who are alive because of a pig's valve from their heart. From the bones, cheap wine corks, would you believe? Stabilizing propellant and bullet making, inkjet paper, concrete, match heads, bone china, train brakes, yogurt, which you correctly mentioned.
What's a train brake?
It's stopping a train.
Yeah,
for stopping it.
He's basically a trotter out. He just leans forward.
Fabric softener. Who knew? Beer, wine, ice cream. From the fat, biodiesel, soap, shampoos, crayons. From the blood, cigarette filters, amazingly, toothpaste, and also paintbrushes. chemical weapons testing. The ears are used in chemical weapons testing. Don't ask me why. I should hasten to add that not all toothpaste and not all yogurt contain it, but if you are a Muslim or Jewish, you've got a hell of a problem discovering what's got pigments.
You have your work cut out.
You have your work cut out like a silhouettist. According to Bloomberg, there are 42 major areas of manufacturing that entirely rely on pork products. It's quite astonishing what that one animal can do. And it's the only farmyard animal, if you discount truffle hunting, that is only useful when dead. It has no
Oh,
use.
You say that. You've never gambled with a pig.
Oh, come I know.
We're terrible gamblers. Poker, blackjack.
But obviously ducks and geese and hens lay eggs and goats give milk and cows give milk and sheep
companionship?
Give...
Companionship?
Oh, companionship. Love. I know they do offer those. They, it is
My
true.
My brother's got a pig, and that's very true of that one.
Yeah, they are very endearing animals.
Tell him to be careful, though, because I knew a farmer that had a heart attack while he was feeding his pigs, and they ate him.
Oh, yes. Well, I'm afraid.
You don't want to get into a pen with one that's approaching sexual maturity, as I know to my cost.
Really?
Yeah. It's basically like
How
a
are the piglets?
They've got names, Alan. So, yeah, it,
Porky
it's
and
like...
Perkins.
Pinky and Perkins.
It's scary. It's like a pork piano, because they breed pigs very long now, because everyone likes chops.
That's right.
You get incredibly long
with
pigs.
With a huge row of udders you can see on the sour, can't you?
And, just runs at you in a sort of matey way.
This was obviously the boar, the male.
Yes.
She
wasn't interested.
No, she wasn't.
Although I was trying to catch her eye.
This is a fainting goat. Everything
I do. I have heard of them, because I've seen the television version of this. It's a breed or a variety of goat which falls over rather suddenly.
When it's nervous.
I think I can only think of one use for it. If you were to dramatise some 19th century novels, but using animals, when the heroine had to swoon, like that, you would cast the goat to do that.
You
so
would.
That would be an immediate and a practical use for a fainting goat. But they're just like a race of goat. I don't know what, like an Anglo-Nubian only. These are fainting
race.
Goats. They're in America, and that's the limit of my knowledge.
Well, if they faint when they're nervous, then they would presumably alert you to danger on the perimeter of your farm. Perhaps Nazis were rearing up over the hillock.
Or wolves attacking or something like that. Or
well,
dogs
wolves.
Next door neighbor.
They're extraordinary. They're called the Tennessee or myotonic goat. You keep them with a flock of sheep, and when the wolf comes, the poor goat, whenever it gets a fright, goes stiff as a board and just goes over like that. So the sheep all escape, and the goat gets eaten because the goat is
there
less valuable
are, yes.
than the sheep. Just, yeah. So it's not that it warns the sheep, it sort of warns the sheep, but
it's not much of a long life for the goat.
So it takes one for the team, is
it? It takes one for the team, takes the bullet.
So they actually do faint with fear. Do they do that as they go down?
Yeah.
It's called myotonia congenita, and it occurs in several species, including humans. It only lasts about 10 seconds. It goes as stiff as a board, then it returns to normal. Apparently, it's painless, according to humans who suffer from it, at least. Apparently, the older and more experienced fainting goats lean against things to stop themselves falling.
Somebody hold me up. It must be quite hard to become an older fainting goat, though, because the wolves are generally biting your throat.
That
out,
but... is the problem.
Yes.
But fainting goats protect your flock by swooning and being eaten by wolves, while the sheep make good their escape.